Good afternoon. My name is Alan Rudolph. I'm the Vice President for Research here at Colorado State. We're really pleased to have Professor Ron Weiss with us in the Aspire Series today. The Aspire Series was created by our office a few years ago to bring in thought leaders around different areas of campus and immerse them with faculty, students, and then hear a lecture at the end of the day. And we're really pleased to have Professor Ron Weiss here with us today. He's one of the pioneers in synthetic biology. He's been engaged in this research area for nearly 20 years or more, starting as a graduate student at MIT. And after his completion in 2001, Ron joined the faculty of Princeton from 2001 to 2009 and then returned to MIT to take on a tenured faculty position there. Ron's focus has been primarily on synthetic biology and the circuits and cell behavior that can be constructed and modeled to look at a variety of both fundamental questions as well as how they apply as we're seeing the tools of genetic engineering apply more and more across different sectors. A major thrust of his work has been around the synthesis of gene networks engineered to perform analog and digital logic computations. And these approaches have really, I think, opened up a very strong avenue within synthetic biology to make it more interdisciplinary and have us really realize how different disciplines can contribute to areas like synthetic biology. His research in synthetic biology was named by MIT's Technology Review magazine as one of the 10 emerging technologies to change your world. In 2004, he was chosen as a finalist in the World Technology Network Biotechnology Award and then selected as a speaker at the National Academy of Sciences in the Frontiers of Science Symposium. Over the last few years, he's had a really outstanding publication record. I encourage you to look at the publications coming out of the Weiss Lab in journals such as Nature and Science, PNAS. We're really pleased to have Ron here. He comes frequently to Fort Collins. I think this is your third trip. And really pleased to introduce and listen to Ron's lecture on synthetic biology. Thanks, Ron.
Thank you. Okay. Well, that was loud. So thank you. Pleasure to be back here. So I think last time I was here is about 3-4 years ago. And just even seeing how CSU has developed is amazing. And so many cool new buildings. I'm very jealous of all of these very cool buildings. And it's lovely to walk around on campus. And also, in addition to that, obviously, the really increase in synthetic biology research here has been amazing as well. So that's another thing that I'm very excited about. And one of the other reasons I come here a lot is actually to poach your students. So there's a kind of funnel, a pipeline of students that come from CSU and end up as postdocs in my lab. So if you are a student and you're looking to come for a postdoc position, please come and find me. And I'll try to continue that pipeline, please. What I'll do this afternoon is I'll talk a little bit about our research in mammalian synthetic biology, and I'll focus on foundations and therapeutic applications. And as a graduate student, going back to around 1996 is when I began to work on synthetic biology, I actually got introduced to it from a computer science perspective. So I'm actually a computer science major or PhD by training. And so for me, synthetic biology has kind of similarities to what happened in early computing, which is something that I also used to teach. And so this notion that in synthetic biology, we're building basic devices and trying to understand then how to characterize these basic devices and put them together to create systems, somewhat relatively small systems, but understand how those work together. And so in terms of the progress in the field, there are many ways of trying to quantify that. And one way to quantify that is to look at the circuits and their sizes over time. And so, for example, here what I'm showing you is on the left side. This is a circuit that was about half of my PhD. And it took me about 3 years to actually build this and to get this to work. And in comparison, now we can take undergrads and teach them how to hold pipettes. And then the following week, they can build circuits that are much more complex than this. So at least, there's been some progress in the field since then. And this, in terms of the size, this has 3 transcription units. And you look, 2004, we had a circuit that hit 6 transcription units, kind of the basic building blocks. The largest currently published circuit that I know is from one of my colleagues, Chris Voigt. It's a 4-input AND gate, has 11 transcription units. And then one of the things I'll talk about, the last thing I'll talk about today, is work, a paper that we have under review that has 15 units to it. So the good thing, as opposed to Moore's law, this is still going up. You know, this is not going up very fast, but there's tremendous number of things that you can do when you're able to genetically engineer individual cells with circuits that have 15 components to them. And so this has really expanded the types of capabilities and applications that we can really pursue in synthetic biology. And by the way, just as I'm going to have, you know, about 7 to 8 slides talking about kind of general introduction to synthetic biology. I figured there would be some, you know, diverse backgrounds in this audience. So for those of you that know about synthetic biology, you know, listen anyways. But it'll be kind of some background into synbio. Another way to think about synthetic biology is in terms of the phases, as I like to call it. And so kind of the first phase of synthetic biology, we are building basic modules. So things like a toggle switch by Jim Collins, oscillator by Michael Elowitz, and we did engineered cell-cell communication. So this was around 2000. And this was proving that we can now engineer cells to do something non-trivial that has kind of computational flavor to it. The second phase of synthetic biology was one, so like around, you know, 2005 to 2010 and slightly after that, was focused on then taking these basic modules and then composing them together to create slightly more complex systems. Okay, so synchronized oscillators. I'll show this spatial patterning that we did with this kind of bullseye. And so that really showed us that, you know, we can begin to think about systems in synthetic biology. And the more recent phase in synthetic biology focuses, I think, it makes it rather exciting to think about how these things matter. Okay, and so it's a lot of fun to make bacteria that blink. Don't get me wrong. We certainly enjoy that. We make all kinds of patterns. But what's going on now is that there's a real interest and also initial progress on creating real applications. So things that can really, you know, change either industry in terms of, you know, designer metabolic networks, or things that allow us to really, you know, fight cancer, for example, with engineered CAR T cells in ways that were just not possible before. So in programmable organoids as well. So I'll talk about cancer immunotherapy and organoids. That'll be something that I talk about. And in situations where I think really the notion of programming cells fundamentally changes the way we approach these particular areas. And so when we think about programming cells, the way I think about it, many other people in the field, is that we look at this as a programmable substrate, and we often think about what is the behavior that we want to be able to embed in these cells. So we can write that out as a program that is actually well-defined. So there's nothing vague. This is a well-specified program. It doesn't have to be digital. You know, it can be analog. It can actually even have fuzzy logic. But it is clearly and well-specified what we want. It can have, you know, stochastic elements to it. Those are all fine, but it is clearly specified. And then what we do is we take that behavior and try to map it out to regulatory networks and then try to understand how to take these regulatory networks and embed them on a piece of DNA, which we can then put inside the cells as a way to extend or modify the behavior of cells in a programmable fashion. When we think about this, so some of us, for example, come from this kind of engineering background, but others come from different kinds of backgrounds. And so, you know, I think for synthetic biology to really be successful, it's important that there's a notion of convergence, a notion that we try to borrow principles from other engineering disciplines, such as rational design, computational models, but also combine them with things that are more relevant to the biological substrate. So what are nature-inspired principles for design of system? How can we use things like directed evolution, you know, to be able to engineer these complex systems? And then in addition to that, how can we take, completely different approaches and bring them all together to be able to create new engineering discipline that really, you know, borrows on many different kinds of expertise. So this is really interdisciplinary in nature and requires many different kinds of perspectives and approaches. One thing that I would say is actually true for almost everything that you see in synthetic biology, and what has essentially become the central dogma in synthetic biology, is this notion that almost every system that we build has these three elements to it. So some sensory capabilities, a computational kind of module, if you will, and actuation. So what we do is we embed in the cells mechanisms by which they can sense what's going on inside the cell or in the environment, provide that information to a computational core, a biological computational core, which then is used to control things inside the cell or outside the cell. And so almost everything that you see in synthetic biology has this sense, compute, actuate components to it. And we often use this notion of logic to understand how to take multiple pieces of information and have the cell perform sophisticated operations. And so it's nice to think about logic like this, and you can oftentimes, or almost always, convert that logic into gene regulatory networks to actually implement that logic. And so this is, you know, a nice way to think about cells, and perhaps a little bit misleading. We often have to remember to be humble in terms of synthetic biology, and remember that these things that we're modifying are really just small little applets in an environment and in a context that we only, you know, slightly understand, okay? And so the question is, how do we actually succeed in this environment to be able to do things in a predictable fashion? And so this is my perspective of synthetic biology as a graduate student, this nice modular, plug-and-play system. And I figured, we'll figure out a little bit of biology. It might take us a couple of years, you know, but we'll program the cells, no problem. I wouldn't say this is my perspective of biology now, but, you know, certainly as I've aged and, have more gray hair and so on, I've learned to respect biology a little bit more. So I wouldn't say I'm kind of over on that side of the, you know, equation or the spectrum. I'm still like, you know, let's figure out how to do things in a modular fashion sometimes. But I'd say maybe one-third of the way there. But it is important, and we do this more and more, is to understand what are the challenges in engineering biological systems. What is really unique? So, for example, rules of composition, is 1 plus 1 really equal to 2 in biology? And so in certain cases, we've actually been able to prove that we can actually have very accurate predictions. But other cases, you know, the predictions are not as accurate as we would like them to be. So we have to deal with gene expression noise, the fact that these cells mutate, the fact that these cells die, and so on. And so this makes it challenging, but it also gives us lots of, you know, work to do and grants to write and things like that. And so the question is, how do we combine systems in synthetic biology to be able to really achieve robust engineering of cells? And so this will be kind of my last high-level, you know, overview of synthetic biology. So oftentimes, we think about these layers. So synthetic biology relies on large-scale DNA assembly and delivery. And much of the progress, not all, but a lot of the progress has been driven by the fact that we can build DNA a lot faster. And that allows us to then create these modules, switches, oscillators, you know, logic functions, and so on. And then I would say probably synthetic biology is about the system design. How do we bring those modules together? And once we're able to do that, how do we address particular areas? So my lab in particular focuses on health-related applications. Okay, that's the thing that I mostly get excited about. But there are many other things that are, you know, that synthetic biology can change the world with, whether it's plants, which is, you know, there's a lot of potential there, and that's going to happen thanks to some people in this room, and bacteria and yeast and so on. So a lot of exciting areas. And I'll focus today on regenerative medicine as one area, cancer immunotherapy. I'll also talk about something else. But what I want you to also take away from this, so even if you don't care about curing cancer, you know, first of all, shame on you, but think about the modules and the technologies that I'm discussing, and think about how those might be applicable, you know, to other areas of interest as well. And so what I'll do is I'll talk about organoids first, I'll talk about the cancer classifiers, and then I'll talk about the protein-protein circuits that we do. In terms of the number of transcription units, it'll increase. So the organoids have about 3 transcription units, some of the circuits, and then 6, and then 15. But it doesn't mean that you know, that's not the only thing that matters. So in terms of biological complexity, you can certainly argue that organoids and, you know, in cancer are rather complex. And I'd say within the context of what I'm showing you here with protein circuits, it's a little bit lower. So that, you know, there's kind of, you know, trade-offs in terms of understanding how to make these things work. In terms of organoids, this is actually something that as soon as I realized that we can program, you know, biology, I was like, what could we do with that? And the first thing I actually got excited about, you know, I want to make tissues by design. That's the first thing that kind of jumped into my head, I think on the same day. And as you know, that I figured would take more than the 2-3 years, maybe 5 years or so, right? And so what's the notion here? That take like embryonic stem cells or induced pluripotency stem cells and then genetically engineer them and then grow and get them to proliferate and create all kinds of spatial, you know, or three-dimensional structures and use that as a cues to create organoids, so to basically create differentiation patterns. Okay, and so the question for me or for the people working with synthetic biology and organoids is, how do we create genetic programs that can control the spatial, temporal, and cell type aspects of organoid formation? And so why, first of all, why organoids? Why, this is a hugely exciting area right now. You know, why is it so exciting? So one area is drug development. So if we can create patient-specific organoids, which is, the answer is yes, we can actually do that right now. We can take fibroblasts, we can make iPS cells out of that, and then we can take those iPS cells and create, you know, organoids in a petri dish that are genetically identical to you. Then you can imagine that we might be able to use that in drug development, expose the organoid to particular drug combinations, and that would hopefully be a much better predictor than a random mouse or rat that is not as genetically related to you. And so that's one of the exciting things about organoids, providing disease models. And the thing that probably even more exciting for me is the notion that if I can create a liver in a petri dish, you know, maybe we can use that to actually address liver injury, you know, and so on. And again, they won't have the immune rejection aspects of it because it will be your genetic liver. And so this is an area that, you know, we're super excited about in the lab. And so these are a couple pictures of things that we do. So we genetically encode sensors that tell us, you know, in real time what's going on in the cell. You know, how are particular pathways affected by various drugs? And so, for example, one of the first things we did is we tried to ask the question, we have this liver organoid, we asked the question, how can we measure drug effects on the liver organoid? And I was asking that question, and somebody told me, well, why don't you put Tylenol on there? And so we actually put Tylenol on our liver organoid, and then things lit up. And so one take-home message from this, don't overdose on Tylenol, because it's actually bad for your liver, and I can show you data, you know, in organoids, showing that it messes up your pathway, certain pathways. And then we do things like we build, and I actually talk about how we now are building three-dimensional structures. So we got one of the first things that we did with trying to create patterns was this work, and now this is about almost 15 years ago. And the notion is, and I'm not going to get to all the technical details about that, but at a high level, the notion was we engineer bacteria to secrete this small molecule, what is called quorum-sensing molecule, and it basically diffused to its neighbors, and the neighbors had have a genetic circuit in them that allowed them to detect the concentration of that morphogen. Okay, and based on that level of the morphogen, they're able to make different fluorescent proteins. Okay, and so the setup was rather simple. We put these receiver cells everywhere, and we put senders in the middle. And that's what you're seeing on the top right over there. And basically, we waited 16 hours. We were able to get all kinds of patterns. And we said, oh, this is so much fun. We can make, you know, bacterial patterns. Let's make a whole bunch of other useless patterns. You know, and DARPA's like, why are you really doing this with our money? And we're like, oh, this is for sensory and, you know, can detect all kinds of bad, you know, pathogens or something like that. I don't remember the exact story. I don't know if you're there at the time. No. But, you know, they're eventually pretty happy with this work. But then we said, okay, we now can make spatial patterns in bacteria. And this is actually the time that I said, okay, I'm going to really begin to focus on mammalian synthetic biology. I thought maybe I know enough about bacterial. And so one thing I do want to mention, so this is forgive me for, I think this is one of really two really corny slides that I have today. And so this is one where, you know, you really want to think about organoid formation as an orchestration of events. And forgive me because I know almost nothing about, you know, music. I have zero musical talent. But, you know, I think this is a good analogy because you can think about, you know, engineering the, you know, or thinking about how these individual cells interact with one another, kind of like instruments, where you first have to be able to control them in a basic fashion, and then trying to understand how to get like graded responses in from these entities, and then how to get them to have, you know, series of events that lead to the formation of the tissue. But what's really hard is trying to understand how to orchestrate the interactions between all of those kind of semi-independent but not really independent elements. And I think to be successful at creating organoids, we have to think about how these stem cells really develop and then co-develop to create the kinds of very elaborate structures that we are trying to create. So what are, you know, the question for us is, what are the basic tools for manipulation, and how can we combine these basic tools both in a kind of top-down, here's an organoid that we want to be able to generate, but also in a bottom-up fashion, which is, how do we get the cells in a localized fashion to interact with one another to create the high-level behavior that we want to be able to achieve? And so for that, we've been working on a toolkit for programmable organoids and controlling various aspects of organoid formation. And what I'll do is then I'll go through a few of these elements, a few of these toolkit elements, and then you want to think about how does that particular set of interactions work, but then think about how can we combine them to create even more elaborate structures. So for example, how do we control cell-cell adhesion? How do we get circuits that can identify what is the cell type? How can things sense what's going on inside of them? How can we get cells to communicate with one another? So those are some of the toolkit elements that we have. And so what is our approach here? So we want to be able to create genetically encoded programs that control the differentiation process. So imagine starting from stem cells. I want to say, for example, one of the things that we're still working on is get the stem cells and then get them to differentiate through multiple lineages down to insulin-producing pancreatic beta cells, you know, for diabetic patients. This is one of the things that we're working on in the lab. So if I want to take a stem cell and get these beta cells out of it, so, you know, as a computer scientist, I like to think about this as a program. So basically this multi-step program where I want the cell to really to go through all of these transitions along the way so it becomes as beta-like as possible. So it has all the features. Everything that goes through, you know, is kind of similar to what happens, you know, in embryogenesis. And so that means that this is a multi-step program where I say go from stem cells to endoderm. So it's like an if-then statement. So if, you know, I get it going, then express these self-fate regulators that drive that process from stem cells to endoderm. And then when the cell reaches the endoderm state, it actually knows from the genetic circuit that now it's time to move on to the next phase, you know, to pancreatic progenitors, and the next phase, and the next phase. So the genetic program at the single cell level is regulating all of these events. And I would argue that to do it properly requires synthetic biology, because we really want to be able to have that control where the cell, when it is ready, is able to make that decision to move on to the next phase and move on to the next phase. And it's something that is essentially impossible to do kind of from the outside. It really has to be something that's embedded inside the cell. And this is just showing you kind of one path. But imagine that we want to create a whole pancreas, you know, how do we actually achieve that? So that's kind of our vision. And so experimentally, then we're asking the question, okay, let's take step one. Okay, so step one is go from stem cells to endoderm. And when we started this, it was not, you know, nobody, you know, it was not known how to do that genetically. And so we said, okay, how could we go from stem cells to endoderm? Let's express GATA4, GATA6, SOC17. These are self-fate regulators that are implicated in endoderm maintenance, and they have this positive feedback regulation between them. So theoretically, based on what was known, expressing any one of them should activate the others. So you know, the biological literature told us express any one of them, you'll get the same thing. That turns out not to be true. Okay, so as part of actually doing this process, we realized that what was kind of speculated by the biological system was not exactly right. Turns out the GATA6 were the only ones that actually worked for us. Okay, I won't go into the details of why we think that's why the others didn't actually pan out. We have some theories about that, but experimentally, here's what we did. So we created this genetic circuit that you're seeing here. So this is one of the simplest circuits that we've created, and basically allows us with a small molecule to control how much GATA6 is produced in the individual cells. Now, one thing that's important about this is that the circuit here was delivered to individual cells, but when we started this, we didn't have the precise control of saying one circuit copy number per cell. We're using lentivirus, and we ended up getting variable circuit copy numbers in the different cells. We weren't too pleased about that, but we said, you know, this is what we have. Let's just go with it. Because usually we try to do very tight regulation. We just didn't have the tools to do that. But we had wide variability in basically GATA6 expression levels. Turns out that was actually the key to success here. Okay, that wide variability was actually the key to success. So let me show you what happens. And so basically in this, what I'll show you here, we had two cell types, one where we induced the GATA6 expression, and it also makes a blue fluorescent protein, and another iPS cells that make a red fluorescent protein. They don't do much in terms of responding to that small molecule, but they're actually, you know, it turns out that we don't really need those. I'm going to show them to you just for illustrative purposes. But here's what we have. So day zero, you don't really see any pattern or anything like that. Everything is kind of mixed. And then day five, there's this cool symmetry breaking that's taking place here, and cells begin to cluster with each other. And when we looked at this more closely, we saw that the cells that were making high GATA6 became endoderm. The cells that were making low GATA6 remained pluripotent. And the cells that had medium GATA6, their outcome depended on their neighbors. So again, this notion that this is not completely a single cell autonomous behavior. This is really a community type of behavior. So we basically have this semi-autonomous switch where, you know, we have high, medium, and low levels, endoderm, depending on the neighbors, or remaining pluripotent. And so this is, when you think about this in terms of the lineage, what's actually going on here is we have the iPS cells, and then there's this bifurcation that happens. And so the high GATA6 become mesoendoderm, and we actually get definitive endoderm and mesoderm out of those. And the low GATA6, if you let them be, they become ectoderm. So now we have actually a mechanism that is highly reproducible, and still I think the only one that I know of from a genetic perspective, that we can choose how much of the endoderm, mesoderm, and ectoderm we can actually get. And so in principle, this should still allow us to get any cell type, any tissue type that we want. Okay? So we could have stopped there. Luckily, so Patrick Gee is I don't know if I mentioned him, he's a postdoc that did this work. Luckily, he was curious and asked the question, what would actually happen if we just let these cells continue to develop? And so what happened was, is that out of the endoderm and the mesoderm, we had development of a liver bud. It actually turns out that is a liver bud, an embryonic liver, that contains all the cell types that are known to be in an embryonic liver. And I still think it's the only example where there's a liver organoid that actually contains all of these cell types. And out of the ectoderm, we actually had the development of forebrain, so basically we have these brain-liver structures. And we also have been looking closely looking at their function. So it's not just the cell types, but they actually have function associated with maturing liver. So in terms of urea synthesis and albumin production, it's really quite high. So really it's indicative of mature, almost mature liver. And so we have interactions, for example, with Merck that they want to use this even right now to begin to test out some of their drug candidates because of the fact that we're getting such high levels of albumin and urea from this platform. And so a graduate student in the lab, Patrick Fortuna, said, let's find out what happens when we put this in 3D. That was in 2D. What happens in 3D? So in 3D, you have these wells, these ultra-low adherent wells, and you basically put about 5,000 cells, and they gravitate to the bottom, and then they become the spheroid, okay? And so one of the issues about organoids is that, for those of you that are in the field, is size, is scale. So you say, oh, these are going to replace the way we do animal models. And then you ask the question, well, how big are they? Well, you can't really see them, you know, and then so they're tiny, microscopic, like, you know, a millimeter in size, and the pharmacokinetics are all messed up. So they're still not great. And so I went back to Patrick. I said, oh, you know, this is a big problem. Let's really work on this. Let's try to make them large organoids. Let's use all these microfluidics. And he's like, Ron, let me take you to the, you know, cell culture. Let me show you something. So he's been culturing these 3D spheroids for 2.5 months. And so this is a picture of them with confocal microscopy after about a month. And you see this vasculature that's like completely embedded in the entire organoid. And then you see this as a petri dish. And so these are individual liver organoids that he's able to create. So they're really huge. They're centimeters across. They're like, you know, enough to play hacky sack with, basically. And so these liver organoids are like hundreds of times larger than other existing organoids. And so our theory is that the vasculature really plays an important role in allowing these to really grow to very large sizes, whereas without the vasculature, you end up getting this necrotic core, which has been the main reason why organoids have not been able to be larger than that. But these vasculature really co-develops with the entire organoid. And so this is additional confocal microscopy. So the take-home lesson, this is a simple circuit. And what we did here is we engineered heterogeneity into the system, and we're able to get really a rather complex entity. And so now we're asking the question, this is a shape that emerged. We're asking the question, can we control three-dimensional shapes? Okay. And the other question is, what if we wanted to make something like a pancreas? So this is actually, we're working on, trying to understand if we can drive it now towards liver, can we have it bifurcate and rather, when it becomes endoderm, rather than go down liver fate, push it towards pancreas? So I'll tell you a little bit about that. And so three-dimensional shapes, so what we're working on with these shapes, one of the mechanisms is to control cell-cell adhesion to create 3D shapes by design. And so for that, we're controlling expression of cadherins. So these kind of serve as like Velcro, essentially, in natural systems. And there's a cadherin superfamily, lots of really cool elements there. And so basically, without cadherin, the notion that the cells are kind of independent, and then as you express more cadherins, the cells stick to each other more. And so there's a seminal paper showing that if you can control cadherin expression, and you have these green cells that you're seeing on the right there that are highly expressing in cadherin, they kind of cluster together, and the cells that are less cadherin expression kind of are kind of creating this shell around this nucleus. And so Jesse, current graduate student in the lab, said, okay, let's try to do some synthetic biology on this and see, can we control this precisely? And so she took HEC cells, which have high cadherin expression, and CHO cells initially, and CHO cells that have no cadherin expression, asked the question, what if we mix them? Okay, so the HEC cells are making a red fluorescent protein, CHO cells are making yellow, and based on what was expected, if you mix them, the red cells would nucleate. And so this is a movie showing that, I guess this is real time. Okay, there you go. That's sped up. So this is about 12 to 24 hours. And you see that kind of the red cells, as expected, are beginning to form a sphere. And then the yellow cells are around them. So that was cool. So this was expected. And then we also said, if we have more red cells, you have bigger spheroids in the middle. And that, that also turned out to be true. So that was good. And then we said, what if we had less red cells? And so they should form this sphere, smaller sphere in the middle based on what was expected. And so here's what it turns out. So this is actually a little off camera there. But what happened was, rather than our expectation to get kind of what's energetically favorable long term, is that we actually ended up getting these small clusters that were distributed. And then for the duration of the experiments, this ended up creating this kinetically trapped mechanism that actually remained essentially metastable in the system. So this was kind of fun to be able to discover. So this was different than our expectation. And so she's been able to use that as a kind of a design principle for creating a bunch of different shapes. So by controlling things like how much cadherin is expressed, what is the, you know, how many cells are expressing cadherins, how many cells are not expressing cadherins, you know, the ratios and things like that, she's been able, in a very reproducible fashion, to control the number of clusters that we have, as well as the size of the clusters. So this is actually super reproducible, and we have 3D computational models that really also correspond to these quite well. And so Jesse's been having a lot of fun with this and creating a bunch of different structures as well by controlling cell cadherin type timing, you know, and ratios as well. So we're beginning to think about this, again, as a toolkit for 3D shape formation for the organoids. And the other thing is that we've also created a computational program where we can now specify, if we want a shape that looks like this, let's write a program that allows the dynamic creation of that shape. And then we have a shape compiler. This is work with Jesse, also Jake Beal, one of my colleagues, a shape compiler that takes that high-level program and then tells us, make DNA that looks like this, and experimentally, here's what you should do. So we have like this little publication on that, and then we're beginning, you know, looking at expanding that shape program as well. So I'm not going to get into the details of that, but if you're a computer science nerd and you want to come talk to me about that, you know, I'll be glad to tell you, go through the details of these programs. Computer science nerd like me, maybe I should have mentioned that. And so then the question is, can we drive the differentiation process? Okay, so I mentioned that we can go one step, but what if we wanted to take the next step, you know, from endoderm to pancreas as opposed to liver, you know, or from pancreatic progenitors to endocrine cells or something like that? And so for that, we need genetically encoded sensors. We need something inside the cell that can drive that process when needed. Okay, and so for that, we've created a variety of different genetically encoded sensors. But let me also point out this process. So what I showed you here is this kind of nice caricature of development. So, you know, in reality, it's not quite that clean. So this is single-cell RNA sequencing that we've done on our organoid. And so this is what's called a spring plot. So a spring plot is a way to look at what happens to these cells kind of over time. So we have day 0, day 5, and day 10 in our organoid. And this spring plot is basically showing, and this is work by same Patrick Fortuna in collaboration with Alan Klein at Harvard, so showing kind of the progression of the cell types that we see over time from day 0, day 5, and day 10. And then you can look at the individual cell types, so you're seeing that in the middle, and these are individual cells. And you see it's not that clean, right? So you have like spreading, you have cells that are kind of over here, you have cells that are over there. So this is, I think, super interesting data in terms of like trying to understand really, you know, how these are asynchronous, what's the diversity, you know, what makes this thing, you know, tick. But then in terms of control, again, I would argue that you really need to have that single cell control. You really want to make sure that you can control when the cell reaches a particular state, how do we drive it towards its next state. So that single cell analysis, I think, is one of the exciting developments that's taking place right now in biology and its impact on biotechnology in general. And then we can infer the lineages from that. And so then experimentally, what we're doing is creating these sensors that will activate at the right time. So for example, we have genetically encoded sensors for proteins. So in principle, we may be able to have a mechanism whereby we can create sensors that can detect maybe the presence of any protein inside the cell, okay? At least in theory. And so the way this genetically encoded sensor works is that we have, let's say, a protein of interest, this NS3, and then we have two proteins, chimeric proteins that we express. One of them is tethered to the membrane, and the other one is free-floating in the cytoplasm. And so when that NS3 protein is present, it brings together those two engineered proteins, and then this protein right here will end up cleaving with this TEV protease, a TEV cleavage site, and release this transcription factor, which then translocates into the nucleus. So we have a mechanism whereby the presence of the protein of interest results in gene activation. Okay, and again, as long as we can find two antibodies or intrabodies to two different epitopes in the cell, we have a good fighting chance of being able to create a sensor for that particular protein. So we think this is a general platform, and we're getting pretty good, you know, response rates. So this is about 24-fold response to NS3, which is involved in hepatitis C virus. We can do this for Huntington disease. We've done this for proteins, TAT and NEF, which are related in HIV, and we can also show programmed cell death. So for example, if we can have a circuit that detects the presence of TAT, which is an HIV protein, and if it's there, then it kills the cell very specifically. Okay? So in principle, we can have a mechanism that would kill, you know, HIV-infected cells. Now, with HIV, quote unquote, it's simple, right? So if you have TAT, it's HIV infected. But for many other things in, you know, biology, there's not this one-to-one mapping. Okay, so let me switch gears and talk about cancer, which is a situation like that, where there's not like a simple, almost always there's not this simple, you know, here's a marker for cancer versus non-cancer. And so, for those of you, I think I would imagine most people know that cancer immunotherapy is just been going like gangbusters. It's incredibly exciting to see what, you know, the progress that's been made in the field due to CAR T cells, checkpoint inhibitors. You know, there's also combinational therapy, and many people would argue that cancer immunotherapy will be the way by which we eradicate cancer, and by being able to control the immune system. I think that many people would argue that that is going to happen. And so, but there are obviously many important challenges remain. So, for example, solid tumors are actually quite difficult to treat. How can we find good antigens for solid tumors? What happens when, you know, the tumor mutates? You know, the same antigens don't work anymore, so antigen escape. How can we get this precise control over the immune state? How can we minimize off-target effects? And so, obviously, synthetic biology will, you know, provide all the solutions to all of the world problems, not a biased statement whatsoever. But I would argue that synthetic biology is really poised to address many of these. And so, you know, so I'll talk about one of our efforts. We have a couple of efforts, and they're slightly different for cancer immunotherapy. One of them is this notion of creating these programmed oncolytic viruses. And so what's the approach here? So we've genetically engineered a herpes simplex virus such that it infects cells. And so it's going to infect both healthy cells and tumor cells. And the first thing that it does is it performs a biological computation to figure out, is that infected cell a tumor cell or not? And if the answer is no, it just shuts itself off. If the answer is yes, then it begins to replicate itself and also make other therapeutic proteins. And so basically, you have this selective spread in the tumor. And then the other thing is that you have this initial cancer cell death, because as the virus, you know, replicates, the cells will actually die after some amount of time. It could be, you know, a day or two, could be a little bit more. But the other thing that it does is the virus also encodes these other proteins that help recruit the immune system. So basically create an inflammatory environment. Okay? So it recruits immune cells and also educates them about what are the bad guys, because it results in this immunogenic cell death. And basically the neoantigens are released from the cell, and those are used to educate the immune system and say, if you find a cell that is expressing these neoantigens, you know, go ahead and try to kill it. Okay, and so the hope is that the ultimate, you know, eradication of the tumor will be kind of synergistic with the virus and the T cells that come in and help kill some of the tumor cells as well. Okay, and so that's the operation. So at a high level, again, so this is kind of a schematic of a tumor. You can imagine that it's heterogeneous. So imagine that, you know, some of the tumor has A and B biomarkers that are high. Some other portion of the tumor has E and B that are high. And then there's some healthy cells there too. And so we can think about this as a logic truth table where we would want to say, you know, let's have a therapeutic agent that activates only when A and B are high and C and D and E are low, or when B and E are high and A, C, and D are low, right? So that's kind of the way we're thinking about this. So if we can create a therapeutic agent that only activates under those biomarker conditions, then we can have a very specific, you know, conditional replication of the virus, okay? Right now, using the, you know, the technology that we have in the lab, we can go from this truth table, you know, to a logic circuit. So here's a logic circuit that would represent that truth table, A, B high, and C, and not D, and not E. That's basically the logic function. And then we can create a genetic circuit that we can then put to regulate the conditional replication of the virus. We can do that right now in 5 weeks. So in terms of like thinking about kind of this personalized medicine, it's not pure science fiction to be able to take a biopsy, your biopsy, measure the biomarker levels, specifically microRNA, which I'll talk about, and then be able to create a customized, you know, virus for you. And then if your tumor mutates, we'll take a new biopsy and then be able to modify, you know, your own oncolytic virus for that. So this is the notion. So the first question is the biomarkers, okay? And so I mentioned microRNA. So Jeremy Gamm, who just graduated from the lab, created a library of sensors for microRNAs, and he said, let's pick the top microRNAs, so 620 different microRNAs, and let's create, you know, genetic structures that allow us to quantify the activity of these microRNAs in the cells that we care about, okay? And so the genetic structure of a microRNA sensor is encoded in this DNA, which basically has one portion that makes a blue fluorescent protein, constitutively, so it's always on, and another portion here that makes a red fluorescent protein, also constitutively, but it is downregulated by the presence of the microRNA. And so what happens, I can't use the laser, but what happens on the right side is that you can look at blue versus red in the population. There's basically diversity in the copy number, right? So some cells get a lot, some cells get a few of these copy numbers. But basically, if there's no microRNA activity, then blue and red are about the same. If there's high-level microRNA activity, red goes down, blue remains the same. And that allows you to compute the fold repression, how much microRNA activity is inside, you know, that cell population. And so we can quantify that. So for example, this is showing fold repression in HEK cells versus fold repression in HeLa cancer cells. So if you wanted to be able to create a mechanism that allows you to distinguish between HeLa and HEK cells, fairly easy. So you can choose these microRNAs, or you can choose these microRNAs, right? But imagine if you wanted to be able to distinguish HeLa cancer cells from all other cell types, it needs to be much more complicated than that. Let me skip that. And so the first question is, can we predict? Okay? So let's take three different microRNAs, each one of, you know, measure each one of them, create a computational model, and then combine them to predict what happens when we put all, you know, these 1, 2, and 3 on the same sensor. So this should be like SynBio 101, right? This should be one of the simplest things that we should be able to do. You know, going back to the question of 1 + 1 = 2, or 1 + 1 + 1 = 3, right? And so we said, okay, let's try this. And so we went to the literature and asked the question, you know, what are the existing computational models? And so there was the best model out there is actually a Nobel Prize winner that is served on Phil Sharp, who served on Jeremy's committee. So highly respected model. But it basically says it's synergistic. What does that mean? So here we measured 4 different microRNAs, and then we put them 1, 2 in the 5' UTR, 3, 4 in the 3' UTR, right? So in the 5' UTR, 3' UTR, and then the gene is in between them, okay? And the synergistic model basically said, and I won't go into the details of that, so we measure activity, we create a model, we fit the model, we create the model, and then we do the synergistic, which is basically kind of like multiplying their effects, 1 × 2, 3 × 4, and then we combine them, and it doesn't work, okay? So which is basically maybe the other central dogma in synthetic biology, that nothing ever works the first time, right? And the other aspect of that, if it works the first time, it will never work again, right? And which is unfortunate, but true. And so this didn't work. And so we went back and we asked the question, what's actually going on here? And so Jeremy actually looked a little more carefully about the biological mechanisms. And he came up with a new model, which we're calling antagonistic synergistic, which is, say, OK, biology is not that simple ever. And so what's actually going on here is that 5' UTR and 3' UTR are actually using different mechanisms to create the RNA interference. They're actually, so they're knocking down, translation in different ways. So we actually need to incorporate that into our model. And once he did that, he did the fitting, then he did this antagonism within the 5' UTR, antagonism within the 3' UTR, and then synergy across the UTR. And so once he created that model, his predictions were extremely good. And so he actually created a set of 24 different circuits that are multi-microRNA. And in all cases, his model always worked better than the synergistic model, sometimes extremely good prediction. So at least in this case, we now think we have pretty good predictions about what to do. And then the other thing about this is I think by pushing, really pushing the envelope, we actually learned a little bit of biology as well by pushing kind of the engineering envelope there. OK, and so now, so we have this mechanism basically to detect what's going on with microRNAs. But we need to be able to build classifier circuits. What does that mean? So for HeLa cancer cells, microRNA 141 is low, and microRNA 21 is high. So from a truth table perspective, you want to be able to activate the killer protein when microRNA 141 is low and 21 is high, but not in other cases. Okay? And so you can translate that truth table to a logic circuit. So it's basically not 141 and not 21. And that's the nots come from the fact that the microRNA acts as a repressor. And then you need to be able to flip the 21. And this is the over there you're seeing on the right side. This is the genetic circuit that would implement this logic function. So you basically have 141 directly repressing the killer protein, and then 21 repressing the repressor of the killer protein. So that's how you schematically draw this, this genetic circuit. But again, biology, this is not going to let you cure cancer this easily. So it turns out that this is, not specific enough, and it's low performance. This just doesn't work. Okay. So we went to the drawing board, back to the drawing board, and Jen, former postdoc in the lab, this is actually quite a few years ago. This is now in 2011. Says, okay, we actually need 6 biomarkers, not 2. And I'm not going to go into all of the details of this, but basically these 3 have to be low, okay, and 21 has to be high, and then some combination of 17 and 38 have to be high. So it took Jen about 3 years to build this circuit to really optimize it. This is even a slightly simplified representation of the circuit. But after all that work, he was able to get about a 3- to 4-fold difference between expression in HeLa cells versus the worst behaving cell, which were the HEK cells. So there is distinguishing power. Some other cells are much lower, but the HEK cells, weren't behaving quite as nicely. So that's, so 3-4-fold is not bad, but not really ready for prime time. Okay, and so actually, interestingly, and I'm not going to get into the details of that, but the cell killing was actually not so bad. Actually, better than we expected in terms of the the fold repression. So, and you can read about this in the paper, how we did this and so on. But again, we weren't quite ready to put it in vivo. And so Jin started on this project in 2012, and he said, I can do better. And so he started with this regulatory network. Okay, and so this is showing you repression and activation, right? So the repression are the red with a bar, and activation are the arrow. Oh, sorry. Anything that has a bar is repression, arrow is an activation. He said, here's the initial circuit topology that would respond to these biomarker levels. And so then he added a feed-forward motif, and he added another feed-forward motif, and another feed-forward motif, and a feedback motif, and another feedback motif, and another feed-forward motif. And a quick 6 years later, you got no question. This is pretty obvious, right? This is actually, again, a simplified version. This is a slightly more realistic representation of that circuit. You know, and so we're calling this ginsanity, by the way. And so the circuit, you know, question is, you know, what are the design principles? I'll get back to this point in a second. But importantly, the circuit works well. So we have about 100-fold selectivity now. This is performance that we're saying, oh, yes, this is something we can actually put in vivo. You know, but asking kind of at a high level, you know, what are the design principles? This also begins to look like natural systems, right? You know, so we're asking the question, why do natural systems actually look this messy and difficult to understand for humans? And maybe because they actually need to, due to, you know, maybe the system here is actually much more robust than the way we normally think about, you know, designing biological system. And so kind of one of the fundamental questions that I'm trying to ask now, is this the future of synthetic biology? Will we need to actually create, you know, networks that look like this? And if the answer is yes, how do we do that? You know, what are the design principles to do that? And so to give you an idea of the design search space, so this circuit consists of 6 transcription units. And so this is what Jin has in the freezer right now in terms of the building blocks to build this. Okay, so these are the variants that he has for each one of these transcription units. And so the number of single transcription units variants that he can make, you know, in 3 days, any one of those. He can't make all of those in 3 days, but he can make any one of those in 3 days. And in 5 days, he can make any one of those. Okay, so that's 10 to the 138. So not a small number, especially in comparison to the number of atoms in the universe. And so, you know, we're asking, how do we deal with this, you know, this design space? This is where I will pause and say, we have no clues yet. No, so we have some initial ideas about that, but certainly I would say this is kind of, again, one of the really important questions in synthetic biology. And you don't have to find that one in 10 to the 138. There might be many answers. Right, and there are many ways by which we can think about this. Okay, so they kind of wanted to pose. So again, in terms of if you're interested in this kind of question and you want to come hang out in Boston, come talk to me about that. You know, and so we have chosen HSV1. I don't know how I'm doing on time here. I don't have a. So let me get my. Okay, so let me actually run through this. I want to talk about. One other topic real quick. So we've engineered HSV1. We have some in vivo data that shows that it conditionally replicates in the tumor and does not appear to replicate elsewhere. And then we have also some survival data that looks like that even a single shot of HSV1 seems to have a real therapeutic effect. And the other thing that we thought was pretty cool is that, one important piece of information is that 90% of cancer deaths actually come not from the primary tumor, but actually from metastasis, okay? And it seems like our HSV1 is really good at dealing with metastasis. So we looked at blood metastasis, and we looked at draining lymph node metastasis. We didn't look everywhere, but the places that we looked, our HSV1 really, you know, dramatically extinguished metastasis, you know, and so we're trying to understand why. So we have some theories about why. Did it educate the immune system quite well, or did it selectively also propagate to these regions? So these are the, you know, things that we're trying to understand about the biological mechanism of this therapy. Okay, and so the last thing I'll talk about very briefly is building protein-protein circuits. And so for that, actually, we have some vague notions about applications. But I get excited about this because I don't know, because as an engineer or bioengineer, this I think is super fun. Why build protein-protein circuits on networks? Because it allows us to modulate existing pathways. We can couple them to cellular sensing actuation. It allows us to build, you know, to understand motifs, and I'll actually come back to that point. But the reason I really start with this is because it's fast, okay? So transcriptional networks work on the order of tens of minutes to hours. this works on the order of seconds. So it really opens up many opportunities for doing biological networks. But even though there's been like protein devices that have been built, there's never been a protein-protein circuit that's been built that's based on fast, reversible interactions. So actually, Michael Elowitz had this cool paper, I don't know if people know about CHOMP, which is based on protein-protein interactions where they cleave each other. And he scooped us. For 2 months later, we managed to get our paper out, basically on similar technology. So I'm happy for him in a way. But Michael's awesome, so it's cool. But it's not reversible. So these things work on the order, again, of tens of minutes to longer than that. What I'm going to show you here works on, again, on the order of seconds. Okay, and so we have to build devices. So we built an OR gate using protein phosphorylation. Quickly, how does that work? So we have Cre1 and Stat5. This is work that's done in yeast, by the way, taking elements from yeast, but also mammalian, bacterial, and plant. So I think Cre actually is a plant one, and Stat5 is mammalian. And so basically what happens if either one of those is phosphorylated through histidine kinase response regulators, the phosphorylation ends up converging on YPD1 and phosphorylates that. So if either is phosphorylated, then YPD1 is phosphorylated. That's an OR gate. And so this is the circuit that was used to test it. And you'll have to just trust me that it works. And then we can also build a NOT gate. So the way the NOT gate works is that we have a HOG1 cytoplasmic, typically. And in the nucleus, we have JH1, which is a domain of JAK. And so when HOG1 is not phosphorylated, JH1 is autophosphorylated. And then we added some additional domains, such that when HOG1 is phosphorylated, it actually translocates into the nucleus, binds HOT1, and then this PTP domain dephosphorylates JH1. So basically, we have a NOT mechanism, right? So HOG1 phosphorylation leads to JH1 dephosphorylation. Why are, and then again, obviously it works, right? Everybody believe it? Cool. So why are the NOT gates and the OR gates so important? Because if you build NOT gates and OR gates and you can connect them to each other, then theoretically you can build any kind of logic that you want. And so then the question is, what do you build? And so in synthetic biology, as a first project, you have three options. You can either build a toggle switch, an oscillator, or a logic circuit. I think you're not allowed. The buy rules say you're not allowed to build anything else. So we said, OK, let's build a toggle. And so this is the toggle. Again, just for the sake of time, I won't get into the details of that. But basically, it's this cross repression. Either this domain is active and it represses the other one, or vice versa. Okay. And so we needed all of these logic gates to be able to do that because of the way we had to connect all of these phosphorylations. And so this is the the logic circuit representation. And then we have an OR gate, we have a NOT gate, we have another NOT gate, we have an OR gate. And there you go. So this is our protein phosphorylation circuit, where either that's high and it dephosphorylates the other branch, or the other branch is high and it dephosphorylates. So bistable. And we can very quickly switch between the states. So here, and basically you can see that by nuclear localization of the HOG1 GFP. And so it can go, it can go in and out, and the yeast are happy to do it as long as you want, but then, the graduate student gets tired of the experiment. But these are, these are very, very stable on and off. And the other thing that's cool is you can have a 1 second transient input, and it's flipped forever, basically. Okay, and then you can flip it back with another 1 second input. So this super fast responding. And again, if you have specific areas where you think that this kind of 1 second input related to phosphorylation states or something like that is of interest, let me know. And I'd love to collaborate with people on it. But kind of the last thing that I wanted to mention very briefly is that it actually, the circuit that I showed you is, again, rather complex. It's actually not exactly the way we think about building toggle switches. So a high level, yes, this represses that, they call repress. But we had to build this very complex network. And we're asking the question, maybe we should think about biological systems also from, you know, how could that help us think about biological systems? So, you know, deciphering protein networks, you know, there are many ways by which this is done, motifs, genetics, informatics. Is there another way? So we're arguing that, you know, maybe what we can do is we describe a high-level function, such as a toggle or something like that, and then define many possible structures that can implement that function, and then search for it. Now, as far as we know, nobody's actually looked at, you know, systems biology in this particular way. That, you know, there wasn't necessarily reason to do that. And so we did this for the toggle switch. So high-level description, structural specification. We then looked for networks, and then we experimentally discovered them. So again, very quickly, so we created a model of yeast phosphorylation networks, and we defined structures that would potentially lead to bistable systems. We found about 109,000 possible toggles. We couldn't test all of them, but we decided to experimentally test about 183 of them, because we had access to small molecule kinase inhibitors that allowed us to modulate these phosphorylation in these endogenous pathways. And indeed, experimentally, we're able to discover 10 new toggle switches that had this kind of different structure to them. So we, and these are, and again, I won't go through all the details about that, but 10 new topologies that haven't been discovered yet. So we thought this is, you know, this is kind of fun, and maybe allow us to again explore many other kinds of yet to be discovered functions in various endogenous pathways. And so kind of the notion here is, you know, synthetic and endogenous analysis. So you can start with something like that. You can then create devices that create the circuits. You can optimize it to give you the data, but then you can think about how can that new structure allow you to think about, you know, motifs that are found in the endogenous network, and then, you know, have that feedback to biological inspiration to how would we create new kinds of structures. Okay, so to quickly summarize some of the technologies, so we created, you know, it's all based on, much of it is based on large-scale DNA assembly. We created these very large 3D vascular liver organoids. I talked about the various kinds of sensors. So we hope to be able to sense anything in the cell, but not just sense it, but then actually connect it to actuation, kind of timely actuation that then allows us to rewire the state of the cell. I talked about these multi-input classifiers, the conditional replication of the oncolytic virus, and these fast phosphorylation circuits. So kind of takeaway messages are some of the kind of high-level things. Engineered heterogeneity, not something we usually think about, but could be a very interesting design principle for synthetic biology. Complex, messy, and redundant design maybe is the way of the future. Remains to be seen, but there's some initial indication, at least here, that's been quite useful. And then again, synthetic circuits may inspire us to think about natural systems in a new light. But again, you know, feeding back into the synthetic systems that we're building now are getting much more complex, and I don't think that the principles that we are using now are the right ones to make things work as we scale up and as things get more complex and as the circuits begin to interact with a cellular context in much more elaborate ways. Okay, so I'll skip this and then thank the people that have done the work. So Subayo did the initial bullseye. I mentioned Jesse for the shapes, Patrick Gee and Patrick Fortuna on the liver stuff, Jen on the cancer, Jeremy on the microRNAs, Jin also on the cancer as well, and then Deepak, who worked on the protein devices, and certainly, oh, I have to also thank, always make sure I do that, thank Tom Knight, who was my PhD advisor that got me hooked on synthetic biology and have not been able to unhook myself from that since then. I think it's okay. And then certainly thank you for your attention, and thanks.
So I think even though we are technically over time, let's not worry about time. This is exciting talk and have some questions. So, yeah.
So you mentioned you can create a NOT gate and an OR gate, and so you can build any circuit. But that requires the various OR gates that are connecting to have independent, quote, wires.
Yeah.
Can you create, like, artificial proteins that you would use to communicate from one OR gate to another?
Yeah, so that's a great question. That's the reason that we had to engineer the system in a way, because it's not completely possible to create any kind of connection. And that's very hard to do. We do have certain design principles that allow us to make connections in certain situations. And so one of them is what we call phosphorylation-activated localization, whereby if something gets phosphorylated, then it basically will bind another domain. So we can actually take two domains that will bind upon phosphorylation one, and then we fuse it to another domain, which will act either as a kinase or a phosphatase to a second domain on the target protein. So it's not about engineering an individual protein. It's about taking protein domains and then fusing them together so that we can get phosphorylation-dependent dephosphorylation or phosphorylation-dependent, phosphorylation. And that the fact that they come together, and there's many protein domains that do that, many pairs that allow you to do that, and then you can basically take, phosphatase or kinase that is somewhere, that has to be really localized in order to be able to affect, the other domain. So that's one of our design principles. And it may not work for all proteins, right? But, if we can find enough pairs like that, then that allows us to create the topologies that we're interested in building.
On your protein-protein circuits, what is like the threshold of detection for sorbitol, and like is that tunable or adjustable?
Yeah, okay. So I'm gonna apologize, but I'm gonna show you a slide on that if you don't mind. That's actually one of the things I was hoping to talk about, but I thought realistically, I would run out of time. And so this is this notion of what we're calling toggle switch ultrasensitivity. So in particular, we looked at an open network, so sorbitol to the nuclear fluorescence that we can measure, and then versus a toggle network, so that's one with the feedback. And we asked the question, what is the sensitivity of the two different approaches? And so you see this is time. This is a 2-second sorbitol pulse input. And these are different concentrations. So 0, 100, and so on, of sorbitol. And basically, you're seeing that the open network you can't detect anything at least until like 1,000 micromolar, so 1 millimolar. And then you can see a little blip here, and then you can see it rather well. But then in the toggle network, which we thought was super cool, is that in situations where you can't see it yet, actually a fraction of the population actually flips to the other side. So there's a statistical situation here where some of the cells are kind of, we think, are primed to make that flip, even though it's extremely low concentrations that you can't even observe. So I think that ultrasensitivity is a kind of a really cool feature of this toggle network. And so we quantified it there. And so I think we can actually go down to 30 micromolar and still have a reliable fraction of the population flip. And then we also created, so we quantified that, and we also created a computational model, a stochastic computational model that is able to kind of capture that with this, imagine that you have these two attractor states. And then with sorbitol, kind of the fluctuations move a little bit. And then a few of the cells will migrate over to the other side. And so this is our model that's able to recapitulate what we're seeing. And then they go back and kind of bifurcate.
That's very interesting. Have you looked at any kind of phenotypical differences between those? You say some are primed and some are not primed.
Yeah.
Is there any way through machine learning, looking at, say, shapes or
yeah.
other activities of those cells, that you could determine prior
yeah.
to giving that, which ones would be prior?
Great question. We haven't looked at that. It's a fantastic question. I don't know. I wonder if we can look at the data that we have, because we do a lot of microscopy for this. So maybe, I don't know, maybe a cell size, maybe there's something about, you know, is it about to bud or something like that? It's a fantastic question.
Any kind of historical
yeah.
perspective of
yeah. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, awesome question. Love it. Okay, so I will go back to my postdoc tonight, and he's in the process of revising the paper. I was like, got to look at this question. We'll give you the credit if we find anything.
That's an awesome question. You can call it Max. Max, okay, yes.
Any more questions? I had one little question about your sensing circuit. If you want to really send something which operates this fast, what's the readout going to be? Like the nuclear translocation is still in minutes, right?
No, it still happens in seconds.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so we can actually visualize. Yeah, seconds. Yeah. It's actually asymmetric, so it actually goes into the nucleus faster than it comes out.
Okay.
But you know, we see it like in the order of seconds. Yeah. So in terms of actuation, I think that, you know, nuclear localization then can be hooked into actuation mechanisms, right? So one of the things that we did was control yeast budding. So basically, I think, what was the name of the BEM2 or something like that? So basically, when it's in the cytoplasm, then it allows yeast to bud, but then if it gets nuclear localized, it represses it, and we get these weird, like, cucumber-like shapes. And so basically, with this one-second input, we're able to control a cell phenotype that's on the order of, you know, multiple hours. Exactly. So right away, anything that's, you know, based on its localization is something we could control. And like I said, I'd love to hear more, you know, more ideas and interest, and I'd love to collaborate with people. And this is with yeast, but we're also interested in doing this in mammalian cells. So we're beginning to implement, you know, some of these pathways in mammalian cells. Because you can imagine, you know, we actually had this other weird thing where we could do this for, like, opioid drug addiction. So you can actually sense the level of fentanyl and then have a very fast response that would actually downregulate, you know, the levels in somebody who is actually addicted. So you can imagine. So this is a completely crazy thing that I thought about when I was at NIH a week ago. And so this, because it's the head of NIDA, so it's a National Institute for Drug Addiction. So she said, you know, this obviously it's a major problem. So I was like, what if we, again, pure craziness, what if we can embed cells in alginate beads, which is actually, you know, there are actually companies out there doing that. We're actually beginning to do that too. So that part is not crazy. And then embed them, you know, maybe in the peritoneum or something like that, and have them basically act as sensor actuators so that they could very quickly, you know, detect the levels maybe of fentanyl and then respond to that by maybe secreting enzymes that would actually downregulate them, come up with some kind of homeostasis mechanism. Maybe it's not completely crazy, by the way. But, yeah. Well, but no, so you could, so you would embed it in alginate beads,
right.
And so the notion is that as long as you, in, yeah, so the, you know, the, I don't know what the dynamics are, so it would have to be cells that somehow have access to the bloodstream, and they would be, yeah, something that titrates it away, yeah, exactly, and I think, you know, so I don't know the pharmacokinetics, because I have not had the chance of thinking about it in the last, you know, how many hours, 72 hours or so that I've been thinking about it. But yeah, you know, but something like that, I think.
Maybe.
Well, in the interest of time, I think we should end here, and let's thank Ron again.